The theme music from The Mandalorian is an absolute masterclass in how to tell a compelling story without having to say a single word. Hey everybody, my name is Levi, I'm a musician and sound designer, and today we're going to be analyzing the badassery that is The Mandalorian soundtrack. Let's take a look. The Mandalorian, first released in November of 2019, is a space western set in the Star Wars universe. The show follows the life of Din Djarin, the Mandalorian, and his adventures across the galaxy. Disney's choice of composer for the show was an interesting one. Ludwig Göransson's writing credits include Daylight. And but in a way, he's a perfect choice for a show cemented in years of tradition trying to create its own identity. The main theme starts with this recurring motif played unaccompanied by a bass recorder. An odd choice of instrument to hold the melody, and one that certainly triggers painful memories of elementary school music class. But as with choice of composer, it's oddly fitting. Let's take a look at why that might be. In the Star Wars universe, the Mandalorians have existed for tens of thousands of years. The Mandalorian belongs to a long history rooted in ancient culture. When we consider what makes a sound ancient or old, we might think of monophony, or single-line melodies without harmony. Think traditional folk songs or Gregorian chants. Complex harmony tends to appear much later in cultural musical development. So monophonic texture tends to invoke the ancient in our minds. This is also a shared feature of the bass recorder itself. Wind instruments are among the oldest types that we have. In 2004, archaeologists at the University of Tübingen discovered a 35,000-year-old flute made from a woolly mammoth's tusk. The association we have between wind instruments like the bass recorder and an older, more ancient sound is deeply buried in the way we process and understand music, even if we aren't consciously aware of it. Another aspect of this recorder part that I'd like to highlight is its pitch. If we take a look here, we can see that the notes the recorder is hitting aren't perfectly in tune. They fluctuate. Even the same note here and here fluctuates quite a bit. This can be due to a wide range of things, such as instrument manufacturing errors, inconsistencies in air pressure when sounding a pitch, or inconsistent hole coverage when playing a note. This inconsistency is what makes the melody sound so organic. Just to prove this, if we orchestrated the same theme on, say, a piano, it loses that seemingly ineffable quality that made it compelling. When you choose to put the melody in a wind instrument like this, you're allowing the audience to follow your breath and let that be the thing that leads your story. This will be a running theme that I come back to over and over again in this video, but it can't be overstated. Orchestration, orchestration, orchestration. The choice of what instrument gets what part and how that's voiced is critical in making or breaking a good score.
This is the way.
Anyway, back to the melody itself. The part is dead simple. The recorder plays the interval of a perfect fifth, which projects stability. That stability is then thwarted with the immediate motion to the minor seventh, an interval which introduces tension and deep uncertainty. Göransson builds on this by moving to the minor third, and finally the fourth. The loop is complete, and it has a strong identity. The outline of this G minor 7 type sound creates an undeniably unique color within the context of the piece's C minor tonality. A delay effect is added to this standalone melody, and the vastness of the Mandalorian's universe is felt in a way that we never have to be told about. Percussive distortion builds underneath as the recorder weaves dense, dissonant harmonies on top of the loop. The music ramps up and suddenly comes to a head. The theme has been stated. The Mandalorian is here. Sounding off like an ancient battle horn, the recorder is overblown, signaling the start of a new section. Interesting side note, and I swear this is the last time I'll bring up the recorder, but we have to talk about this note. Western music is built off the idea of tension and release, consonance and dissonance. We typically think of these concepts in terms of harmony. But I think to be a composer who truly has control over all the sounds that we create, we must apply the ideas of tension and release across all dimensions of our writing. One way to introduce tension without the need of harmony is by way of register limits. When we approach the upper limits of our instrument, whether it be a violin or a flute, it usually sounds shrill and is often difficult to play. The difficulty itself is perceived by the listener. This translates to tension that the listener can feel. Goranssons takes full advantage of this effect by overblowing the recorder at the top of this section. Voiced in the sound of a distorted floor tom, a tribal-like ostinato enters. The rhythmic sequence, sounding like a speeding train or the gallop of horses, reflect the Mandalorian's strong spaghetti western influences. The show often feels like one intense mission after another. The rhythmic context, by design, drives us forward without much time to catch our breath. The melody, on the other hand, gives us space and lets us appreciate the complexity of Din Djarin's character in the face of constant action. The brass section brings in the next melody, and there's this really interesting interplay between the melody we hear and the bass beneath it. Sounds almost like a conversation. The bass moves when the melody is held, and vice versa. The parts seem to be inescapably intertwined, no matter how far the distance between them. The section ends with this eighth note triplet motion in the strings. What's notable here is Goranssons' use of this Neapolitan chord, D flat over F, as a replacement for the four chord in C minor. The motion subverts expectation while at the same time propels us into the familiar. A slight variation on the opening statement then returns in the bass recorder, but rather than being alone, unaccompanied as it once was, it's now supported by the whole ensemble. Maybe the most interesting thing harmonically speaking in this piece is this modulation into the final fanfare. I think this is Goranssons' homage to the Star Wars of John Williams. The nasally, bright brass is instantly recognizable. The modulation, in concert with the timbral palette and orchestration, feels nothing less than triumphant, which is what we're all rooting for. The Mandalorian is an outcast. He is the underdog. And at the end of the day, we all want to see him succeed. The Mandalorian's theme holds within it the characters, the connections, and the emotions between them, foreshadowing the story which it begs to tell. Which is why it truly is a masterclass in how to tell a compelling story without saying a single word. Thanks so much for listening to me geek out on a bunch of Star Wars music theory. I hope it brought something to your day. If you like it, you dig it, you want more, please consider subscribing to the channel. We just hit 300 subscribers not too long ago. I'm gonna do something special at 1,000 subscribers. I don't know exactly what that's gonna be, but if you have any ideas, I'd love to hear them. Please let me know in the comments. Here's a resolution for you, because I don't know how to sign off without it being awkward as f-